sustainable, profitable growth in future. And on that note, I'd like to welcome all our stakeholders, all our members of the audience, as we begin with the proceedings of our first session. Now, before we do that, we'd also like to take the opportunity to thank our partners for their valuable support. Our associate partners, UTI Mutual Fund, Reliance Mutual Fund, NSDL, CDSL, Stock Holding, CFA Institute, and LIC. Our knowledge partner, Crystal Research, and live webcast partner, 24 Frames Digital. Ladies and gentlemen, before we get started, I'd like to invite on stage the sector head of TCL BCCL, Ms. Sandhya Dhar, to set the tone for the first edition of the summit. So can we have a warm round of applause, and please help me welcome on stage Ms. Sandhya Dhar.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all to the first edition of Pension and Retirement Benefits Summit. We know that life expectancy has shot in recent decades. When public pension systems were first established, people could typically look forward to only a few years of retirement. Today, gradually, the probability of a newborn boy surviving until age 65 is over 80%. The figure is over 90% for a girl child. Aging populations are a high-class problem, said U.S. President Bill Clinton in his 1999 State of the Union address. It poses significant challenges for economic, social, and health policies in general, and pension systems in particular. India is no exception to this global trend. Demographic projections indicate that the share of the aged will rise to 9% of the total population by 2016 and to 13% by 2026. Life expectancy has increased significantly in India thanks to economic development and better access to medical care. This also means that a significant percentage of the population is expected to live beyond 75 years of age. Therefore, it is essential that a formal mechanism of benefits to reach a large section of the aged population is in place and cost-effective products are available to the population for creating a retirement corpus. Background of pension reforms in India does not have a universal social security system. A large number of India's elderly are not covered by any pension scheme. Pension reforms and a pension system with greater reach will not only ensure citizens' welfare in their golden years, but will also help the central and state governments cut their future liabilities. With these broad objectives in mind, the Government of India set up an expert committee in 1998 to devise a new pension system for India. Project OSS, which was chaired by Sri S.A. Dave, submitted its report in 2001. The report recommended setting up a new pension system in India and creating a pension system based on individual retirement accounts. Any individual would save and accumulate assets through his entire working life, and upon retirement, the individual would be able to use his pension assets to buy annuities from annuity providers and obtain a monthly pension. The pension amount would be governed by what the employee's pension fund account could earn from market investments. This was a paradigm shift from the existing defined returns philosophy to a defined contributions philosophy. In line with the above recommendations, the government set up its new pension scheme, NPS, which was India's answer to the US's 401k plans. The NPS was launched in 2004 for central and state government employees who had to subscribe mandatorily. In 2009, it was thrown open to all Indian citizens in 18 to 60 age group. However, it has failed to take off in the voluntary segment given the anemic subscriptions from the private sector. The scheme's lack of popularity has been attributed to several factors, such as weak incentives to intermediaries, a lack of awareness among the general population, insufficient marketing and promotion of the product, and lower returns compared to other investment options. Also, the scheme faces stiff competition from the Mandatory Employees Provident Fund, which is EPF, and that remains the main retirement savings instrument for a majority of Indian employees. Given the mandatory retirement contribution to EPF, employees are reluctant to put in additional money in NPS. Thus, the key challenge in India today is to continue the pension reforms while addressing the needs and creating a universal security net for the most needy. We at ETH would like to encourage a dialogue in this area among all stakeholders and industry leaders. And today, through the day, we will hear experts on various panels deliberate on further steps that need to be initiated in this direction. With this, I request the industry experts to take the discussion forward. All the best.